So I'm going to be talking about going one-to-one with Chromebooks today. And my slide presentation is available at bit.ly fallq14-cb121 if you want to follow along. And welcome. So real quick, who in my audience is currently using Chromebooks in their district? All right. Anybody not yet doing it but thinking about it? Okay, so a couple people. All right, so we'll try to cover all those bases as we go. I'm going to talk to you about my epic journey a little bit to get started. For the people at home who are watching this live, if you want to participate, I'll be checking our Today's Meet later. So todaysmeet.com/121CB. Also, if you're in the audience and you want to ask a question but don't want to raise your hand, you can go there and post something. I'll check that and see what we have in there later. So a little bit about how I got started. In the beginning, I was a Windows guy. And this was back in the 2003-04 time frame. Windows everywhere, thin clients. I know, in case you didn't know, this is a technical talk, so I'm going to be talking IT stuff. Yay, all right, I'm in the right place then. But I did a lot of Windows in classrooms, thin clients, Windows desktops, all of that fun stuff, had all the certifications. And then in about 2008-2009 time frame, the netbook came out. If you guys remember the netbook, it was cheap, didn't run Windows that great. And yet, because it was so cheap, we really looked at it as a possible solution to our problem, which was we wanted to get devices into kids' hands. So we found something that worked for us called ubermix.org. It's out there, it's free. It's a Linux-based operating system designed for kids, and it made our netbooks work for us. And we actually ran a netbook pilot in several of our grade levels and decided that we were going to go one-to-one based on that experience. And we were all set to go one-to-one with Ubermix netbooks until the Shiny came along. And we actually did a 90-degree turn and went one-to-one iPads. So in 2011, which was a long time ago in technology time, I took a high school district one-to-one with iPads. So that's a little bit about my experience up until the Chromebook came out. And the Chromebook has only been out a few years now, but it kind of changed everything. And I'm going to talk about how it changed everything and what it looks like to deploy Chromebooks in a district at scale, which is one of the keys to Chromebook deployments. Now, yesterday on this very stage, there was a showdown between two devices. I think there was a clear winner at the end. That's just my impression. But I'm not going to really get into that too much today, OK? We're here to talk about Chromebooks. For me, the reason why I like Chromebooks is because I can get a lot of them into a lot of kids' hands quickly, cheaply, efficiently, and sustainably. And that allows our kids to go to places like this. This is our landing page for our students on their Chromebooks, and it gives them access to all of these different applications really fast. Not to mention the internet and Google Docs, and I'll talk about that too. So who am I? I'm Andrew Schwab. I'm Chief Technology Officer for the Union School District. We're in San Jose. We're a K-8. We're about 5,500 students. And we have 3,600 Chromebooks. Half of those Chromebooks we put out in the last 3 months. I have a staff of 2 site techs for 9 schools, a sysadmin, a network engineer, and me. And so that's a pretty big number. And I didn't put up there the 1,000 iPads that we also support. So I'm going to talk about how we do that. First, we'll start with setting up a Chromebook and how you go through it, because a lot of people want to know what's involved. Well, there's a manual that talks about how to deploy Chromebooks in your environment. Okay, I'll let you figure out what the F stands for. The first step to deploying Chromebooks, you really need to be on Google. Google Apps for Education is the platform that makes all this possible. If you're not a Google Apps district and you're thinking about Chromebooks, you should be also looking at going Google Apps. I think everybody who had their hands up that said they're on Chromebooks should already be on Google Apps, but it's an obvious one that some people may not realize. Step two, you have to buy Chromebooks. And not just the Chromebooks, but if you're going to deploy lots of Chromebooks in the educational environment using your Google Apps for Education account, you also need to buy the Chromebook management license from Google. Actually, you buy it from your vendor, but The management and support automatically shows up in your Google Apps dashboard when you purchase it. So that's a $30 charge, one-time charge for your Chromebook when you buy it. I've actually bought some Chromebooks without that, and we actually just ran into an issue where we were enrolling our Chromebooks into our domain, and we ran out of licenses. And so that was a problem because they don't show up. You can't enroll them without the licenses. The nice thing is, and this didn't used to always be the case, you can just go buy licenses now. You don't have to buy the Chromebook and the license. You can just get a quote for 30 or 100 licenses, and they will show up in your domain. And then you can start re-enrolling Chromebooks. I also get this question a lot. What device should I buy? So back in the, two, three years ago, there really was only one device. How many of you guys have this, the silver original Samsung Chromebook? OK. So that was like the first device that you could buy for like sub $300. And there really wasn't a lot of choice. But now there's a ton of choice. Everybody's making a Chromebook. So what I look for when I'm looking for a Chromebook are these things. I'm looking for build quality, how it's going to hold up in students' hands. If you have some of those early Chromebooks, you know what I'm talking about. Looking at failure rates. I've talked to districts that have deployed large numbers of Chromebooks, and some have failure rates in the 3% range. And when I say failure rates, I'm talking like out of the box, does it turn on? How long, does it last the first year without dying in some way? Not, the kid used it as a Frisbee failure, but did the screen go bad for whatever reason, or did the device stop working? So I'm looking at failure rate because if I buy 1,000 and my failure rate is 3%, that's a different story than if my failure rate is 15%. So big spread. I really like the matte screen. How many of you guys have ever had that glare on your screen when you're sitting in a classroom? Because we all have those wonderful fluorescent lights in our classrooms. Getting a Chromebook with a matte screen eliminates that. It's a trade-off, though, because you don't get as bright a picture or as vibrant color. But for a lot of what students are going to do on a Chromebook in class, not having to contend with that glare is a big thing. Battery life is huge. If you pay attention to the Chromebook that you're looking at, some Chromebooks still today don't last a full day, right? 6 to 6 hours, marginal in a classroom. You're looking for 8, 10, preferably 12 now. And there's really no one place you can go to say, hey, what Chromebook should I buy? So my advice is find somebody who's running a lot of them and ask them what their experience has been. Another important thing to remember when you're looking at Chromebooks, actually any mobile device at this point, but Chromebooks specifically today, it's only a 3-year device. I've talked to a couple of districts, and they have this plan where they're going to use a Chromebook as a mobile device for 3 years and then put it on a desk for another 2, and that's kind of how they've made their refresh numbers work. But really, I mean, if you look at the Chromebooks, we have Chromebooks now that are in their second year of life, and I'm hoping we get another year out of them just because of the abuse that some of them have been through, and also just regular wear and tear. These are very low-end devices. They don't cost that much. And so to expect that they're going to run 5, 6, 7, how long have we run computers historically in schools? 10, 12 years? We have to have a different mindset, and we have to think about the devices changing pretty much every 3 years. This is an advantage, I think, because if you don't make the best choice now, you get to fix it 3 years from now. So you're not doing a lifelong commitment here for whatever device you pick. But it's important to remember. So third step to deploying Chromebooks, you have to turn it on. And I know that's shocking, but you got to get it powered on. And what that looks like is you got to have somebody actually unboxing them and turning them on. So our approach has been to actually hire high school graduates who come in and work for us part-time. And pretty much all they do is unbox, power on, and load into a cart. And it's been a process. It's amazing how much cardboard kind of piles up. And I've been buying our maintenance folks, bagels and donuts because of all the trash that we've had to process. And These things, you know, when you buy 30, it's not that big a deal, but when you buy 1,000 or 1,500 at a time, it really does start to add up. So you got to have somebody turn them on. There are services that you can, they're called white glove. You can contract with somebody who will do all of this stuff for you before they even get the device to you. I did a cost benefit, and it's actually less expensive, and I got a little bit more control to pay somebody $10 an hour to run through a cart than pay like $9 a unit to do it. So, our numbers per cart depend on the grade level it's going into. So we've been doing 32 at the elementary and 36 at the middle, and we have a couple schools or classes where we're usually a couple short, but that can be made up because not every class has 32. You know, some classes may have 28, so you can take two and move them.
But
I do, and I'll get to that. So step four, you got to connect it to the wireless. So that means you got to have wireless. If you don't have wireless, you probably shouldn't be looking at Chromebooks yet. All right, wireless is step number one. The wireless is important. What you'll find is, again, it's a matter of scale. If you're adding 30 devices to your wireless network, not a big deal. When you go to process 1,500 all in the same room connected to the same access point, if you didn't do your networking right, you're going to run out of IP addresses and your devices won't connect. And yes, even we ran into that too. You know, a lot of networks, if they were set up 5, 6, 7 years ago, they can handle about 250 devices per network, right? You turn on any more than that and they won't connect. And so really looking at your fundamental infrastructure before you even start deploying, not that this has happened at my current district, but we deploy and set up all these Chromebooks in our district office, and we have a lot of trainings in our district office. And if you have, you know, 300 Chromebooks all turned on, sitting in carts waiting to go out to schools, and teachers come in and you're trying to do professional development, and they can't get on the wireless because there's no more IP addresses available, that's not a good thing, right? So think about having at least wherever you're going to do your setup and configuration, a network address schema that's going to support as many devices as you think you're going to run through. Also, what we do is we initially set up our Chromebooks on the wireless network that they're going to be on. So for us, it's our student network. So when we pull them out of the box and we join them to the network, we join them to the student network, and that's the only network we connect them to. The idea being is that when they get out to the school sites, they're already going to be on the right network. Now, you can manage that at the console level too, and I'll talk a little bit about that, but that's important. Step five. Control-Alt-E, and then you have to log in with a domain account. This is enrollment. This enrolls your device into your domain. And it basically associates that Chromebook with your Google Apps domain. So believe it or not, when you have part-time help, and they're great, I don't want to say they're not, sometimes they forget this step, and they just log in. Well, if you just log into a Chromebook, what happens is the account that you've logged in with becomes the administrator account on that device, and it's not associated with your Google Apps domain. And that can be a problem, especially when you accidentally send them out to schools. Not that that's ever happened to me. There's a way to recover from that. You basically have to reset the Chromebook and then do the enrollment. It can be time consuming. So this is a very important step that really needs to be, you got to make sure that it gets done before you send Chromebooks out and that your Chromebooks are popping up in your management console, which we'll look at. And step six is, I think, the most rewarding, is we can give students their Chromebooks. And that's basically it. Then you just repeat that process however many times you need to do it. Okay. Any questions on the basics? So the way that's a good question. The question was, do we assign Chromebooks per student? Right now, we're not doing a per student rollout. We're actually doing a per classroom rollout, so we have a cart per classroom. And the way we assign Chromebooks in our console is we actually assign them by cart. So we can create a suborg, and I'll show you what that looks like. So we have a management structure that says all of these Chromebooks belong in this cart, and this cart is at this school. And I'll show you what that looks like. If you really want to know how to dig in and manage Chromebooks, Google has actually a lot of good documentation now. I'm 3 years ago there wasn't much and you couldn't do much, but now you can do a lot of stuff and there's really good documentation. So anybody who wants it, the links, I've put all the links in the presentation. A couple of management tips going to the question right here. The first is you really want to organize your Chromebooks into sub-organizational units. Okay, so in your Google Apps admin panel, there are sub-organizational units that you can create. And most of us probably already have our student accounts and our teacher accounts in different suborgs. That makes a lot of sense. Well, I know of one district that dumped all of their Chromebooks into one place across the entire district. And what happens with that is if you have all of your Chromebooks in basically one big sub-organization, and you have 8 schools, for example, if you want to, for whatever reason, change customization settings for each school or do something different at another school, if you don't have those Chromebooks that are at that school in a suborg, you can't. Because device settings happen via suborg. Okay? It's at the organizational level. So how you organize your Chromebooks is kind of important. Does a student have to be in the same suborg? No. No, they do not. In fact, we just have, and I'll show you, a device suborg, and all of our devices are in organizations under that, and our students are in their other one. Deploying batches, this is really important because it goes to the organization piece. So we deploy a cart at a time, basically. We unbox, set up, scan a cart at a time, and as we're putting it into the management console, we move it into that cart's sub-organization. We don't do 150 Chromebooks at one time and then try to figure out where they're supposed to go. We're very systematized in how we're unboxing, joining them, or enrolling them in our domain, moving them to where they need to go, putting them in the cart, making sure the cart is asset tagged and all that information is tracked before we send it out to the schools. There's a recommendation there which we don't actually do, but we probably should. And this actually manifested itself when we were doing some of our SBAC testing. By default, all of the Chromebooks in your domain are going to be running the stable channel, which is the version of the operating system, the Chrome OS. And you know, Google pushes those OS updates automatically. You don't have to do any updating. It's really nice. You can control, you know, kind of what the randomness is of it. You can stop it from happening. You can lock it a certain version. But you don't have to do anything if you don't want to. Sometimes that gets interesting, especially if every Chromebook in your district is all set to auto update. Sometimes things may not work after the update that you thought should work. And so the beta channel is a step ahead of the updates that are coming out on the stable channel. And Google actually recommends that you take some percentage of your Chromebooks and move them into the beta channel so that they're updating faster than your other ones, so you'll see issues before, theoretically, before they hit the stable channel. Like I said, we haven't done that yet, and we've, aside from that one little incident, have been on just regular updates and haven't had any issues, so. This is what your device management panel is going to look like if you have devices, right? You can see over on the left, these are all sub-organizations that we've created. And up at the top, I have devices. And then underneath that are all of our organizations. We have student Chromebooks. We have staff Chromebooks. It's funny, I found out that staff don't necessarily want to have all the student applications automatically popping up on their Chromebooks when they log in. And they also really don't like it when their profile gets removed from the Chromebook when they log out. So we've split those so that staff have certain settings and students have certain settings, which is nice. But you can see here, you can see your serial number. You get your status. Provisioned is a good thing. If you don't see that, there's a problem. You can see when it was enrolled, the last time it synced. You can see the user that was used. And then we're actually tracking location, and that's one of the things that we enter when we put the Chromebooks into the system. We have to manually enter that right now. And then here you can see we've actually broken it out by cart. So we have the location, and then we have the number of the cart. And we also were putting the teacher's last name. So at least we know when we send a card out to a school, we know where those Chromebooks are supposed to be and what cart they're supposed to be in. And that, honestly, is pretty much all the asset tracking we do with our Chromebooks. You know, they're under $500, so we don't tag them as inventory. I think our next step will be to actually put them into our library system and basically tag them like books and check them out that way. But for right now, this at least tells us where we think they should be. So when you're managing Chrome devices, there's actually a couple settings that you need to be aware of. You can see I have 3,453 active. There's a difference between user settings and device settings. User settings basically affect the user when they log into the Chromebook, right? So it doesn't matter where that user is, what organization they're in, but when they log into the Chromebook, they're going to get whatever Chromebook user settings have been set on that device. And then there's device settings, and device settings are specific to the actual Chrome device. So this comes into play when you look at SBAC testing, or as we in California know it as CASP, which is our online adaptive assessments. SBAC's really easy on a Chromebook. Nothing, really? Okay. Thought I'd get something out of that. Yeah. So the easiest way to implement SBAC on a Chromebook is basically you have to enable something called kiosk mode, right? And in kiosk mode, you can assign specific apps, and they're managed apps. It's literally, you know, like two clicks. You go into the kiosk app selection, and you select Air Secure Test, and you say OK. And then magically, the next time the student logs in, before they even log in, all they have to do is turn the Chromebook on. Down at the bottom of the Chromebook, they'll see a little app that says, it'll look just like that. It'll be the Air Secure Test app. They click on it, and they're in. Okay. No logins for the Chromebook. No having to set any kind of special mode. You just put the Chromebook in the suborg that has this setting set. Next time they turn it on, you're done. All right. Questions so far? Nope, there's no login. You basically, you turn the Chromebook into a kiosk that's running one app. And what's nice is, the way we ran it last year was, we make that available, but we also have the login available. So if the student wants to log in and just do regular work, they can log in with their Google Apps account and work on the Chromebook. When it's time to test, they log off, click on the SBAC icon, and they're into the test. We push it through the admin console, which we manage at the district level. Yeah. But we can control who gets it and when, because it's basically just either enabling that setting in the suborg where the Chromebook is, or moving the Chromebook into a suborg that has it set. We actually have a separate suborg called SBAC, where we can actually just move Chromebooks into it, and as soon as we do that, it picks up that setting, and then they're ready to go for testing. So. Yeah, so the question is, are we going to do that again? Are we going to, we're going to move the devices, or are we going to enable that kiosk mode? Last year, we did not have 3,000 Chromebooks, and it wasn't as big of a challenge to move things around. I think this year, we'll probably just flip kiosk mode on for all of our student Chromebooks at the top level, and then let it trickle down. So I'm going to talk a little bit now about deployment considerations. These are some things that you may not think about. That I've just had experience with that are kind of nice to know. So the first is space, okay? The physical representation of 1,500 Chromebooks is pretty significant. And we carved out, we were lucky, we were reconfiguring our office space, and so we had a lot of open space. But my department's actually really jammed into a tight space. And so we have Chromebook boxes piled everywhere because we don't have anywhere to put them. And unfortunately, when they get shipped, there's just a lot of boxes. I don't know why, you know, they haven't really solved that problem yet. I remember when I was dealing with iPads, they came out with the 10-pack, and there's a lot less boxing in there. There's no, unfortunately, no 10-packs for Chromebooks. So, you know, we're just piling them where we can. It's not only the Chromebooks that take up space, unfortunately, but also the carts, right? This is 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. So this is like, you know, a quarter of the carts that we deployed over summer. And it took up our entire office space. And then you need space to work and do all that. So if you're looking at doing deployment at scale and you're going to do it at your district yourself, you got to have a place to do it. As we start looking at making this a sustainable habit in my district, we're talking about running 1,500 Chromebooks, 1,500 to 1,800 Chromebooks through every year. So that's every summer we're going to look like this. And when you're trying to do other stuff and get other things processed through, this becomes problematic.
Andrew,
yeah?
Can you talk a little bit about why you decided to go Chromebooks in classrooms instead of one-to-one?
Yeah, absolutely. So the question was, why are we doing this cart model, right? Classroom cart based instead of just giving every student a Chromebook? Well, we're taking baby steps. So we started last year with carts in classrooms, primarily 3rd through 5th, and then 6th and 8th, so that we could, you know, do our online assessments, as well as have a transformative environment in the classroom. And looking at where we are just as a district, our eventual goal, which is actually not eventual, it's like the next 2 to 3 years, is one Chromebook per student at the 3rd through 8th level. Next year, we're going to start a one-to-one take-home with students. So our goal is to get every Chromebook going home, not in the classroom sitting in a cart. It's just a process, and you know, this year is all about getting devices. We're going 3rd through 6th grade, every classroom with a cart. Next year, we're going to start the one-to-one in 6th grade, which we will then roll forward for every incoming 6th grader. So within 3 years, it'll be one-to-one take-home at the middle schools. And then depending on where we are, looking at going 1-to-1 3rd grade and then rolling that forward. So within 3 to 4 years, every student 3rd through 8th will be taking one home. There's a lot of benefits to that, right? Kids have access to what they need 24/7. We're not having to keep all of these devices in our classrooms and buy carts, which is an overhead. Charging. I don't know if you've ever experienced this, but when you sometimes in some classrooms, when you plug in 40 devices to charge, the power doesn't like that, and they don't charge. You know, so just electrical capacity in some classrooms may not be up to speed. So there are definitely, you know, physical advantages to sending devices home with kids, but it's a transformation process that takes time to develop and get people ready for. Yep. Say again? Yeah, so the K2, so there, we've been having a discussion about where that divide should be, 2, 3, big question. So what are we doing K2? So K1, we're piloting tablets, iPads, we have some Nexus devices out there. Second grade, it looks like we're probably gonna go Chromebooks based on teacher requests and what teachers have been wanting to do, so. Yeah. So advice on talking to your admin about taking them home. Well, I would say, just from the practical perspective, it's a super cheap device. So if it gets, you know, lost, which I think loss rates are really low anyway, but that's usually everybody's big concern is it's gonna get lost or it's gonna get stolen or it's gonna get broken. Very low cost. The advantage to giving one to a student and assigning it as theirs and letting them keep it all the time is it's theirs. They have an invested interest in it. As opposed to a shared environment where you know, they're maybe using one Chromebook shared with 6 people throughout the day. Instructionally, you know, the ability to go home and access the same things that you're doing in the classroom, I mean, that's huge, right? If you're on Google, you know, your stuff is in the cloud no matter where, but not all students have access to the to a computer, maybe not even the internet at home. Let's see, why else would you want to take home? I think it's responsibility, right? I mean, as a future citizen of the world, we all have devices. We all have 3, 4 devices in our bags now. I think you know, getting students, giving them that access and responsibility is very important as well. So, and I also honestly, you know, how else do you do one-to-one? Because if you're looking at doing one-to-one in school, now you're talking about if you're middle school, what are you going to do, a homeroom? And everybody's going to check out their device the first, you know, first hour, and then at the end of the day, they'll check it back in. Not really practical. If you're in elementary, a little more so, because you can do a cart, and you can assign a device per student, and they can just put it in and out of the cart every day. But, you know, I think eventually every student's just going to have a device, and we need to adapt to that. And that's where we should be going anyway. Yeah.
Andrew, real quick. Uh-huh. So you talked about the importance of putting them into subgroups, and I understand exactly why. What are your thoughts about middle school, junior high, secondary models when you do go one-to-one? What would the subgroups look like?
Yeah, so what would the subgroups look like in the middle school, junior high, when you're going one-to-one? Ours are broken down basically by grade level, and so I think we're not there yet, but I think what we'll do is we'll mirror our student accounts, which our student accounts are basically broken out by our matriculation year and by site, right? So if I think it's logical to have a similar structure for your student Google Apps account and your Chromebook device, and I'm even thinking that if I can make it work, we'll have a, underneath the student suborg, we'll just have a device suborg, which is where we'll put all their devices. Just more space issues, you know. Not only do you have to put the Chromebooks in the cart, but you have to wire all the carts with the power supplies and the power chargers, which means, yeah, it takes time, you know, definitely takes time. And if you have more than one person working at it, that's good. You can get more carts done. We actually found that having two people working on one cart at the same time was really effective. I get more out of these guys when they're working together like that. One thing, and I'm not selling this brand of Chromebook by any means, but it was the picture I had, which has this up on it, which is the etching. So we were, I think, spending a couple bucks for a little property of ID tag, and then having to pay somebody to stick those on the Chromebooks, which, you know, they're handling them anyway, and there's a process for that, but it did take time. What we were finding is that they rubbed off real easy, and you could just peel them off anyway. So for a little bit more, we're actually having all of our Chromebooks etched. This addresses kind of that, well, what happens when you lose a Chromebook or it gets stolen? Well, all of our Chromebooks are marked, right? It's laser etched into the lid. So if we see one on the street, we know that it's ours. If we see a big blank, you know, spot on the right corner of our Chromebook, we're going to assume that it's probably ours too. So, all right, a couple more things to think about. Support. I always get this question. I got to see where I'm at. All right, we're doing okay. Supporting a Chromebook. People say, you know, how do you get support? Who do you call? Do you call Google? Do you call the company that you got it from? And there's a couple answers to that question. The $30 license that you're paying Google for the management, that's like, it used to be a 3-year, now it's a 5-year license. But there's a caveat. It's 5 years from the date that they started selling the model of Chromebook that you buy. Okay? And there's a chart, and I have the link here for you. But for me, most of our Chromebooks that we have, that we've been buying recently, are the Acer C720. And based on when it first sold, support end of life date is going to be out to November 2018. Okay, so there's a matrix that you really need to be aware of, and I'll give you a good example. It doesn't matter if I'm buying these C720s now or 6 months from now. The support date end of life is the same. Okay, just like I said, you can't run Chromebooks without having Google Apps. It's kind of hard to run Chromebooks without having student accounts in Google Apps, right? And so one of the questions I get a lot is, how do we get our students into Google Apps so that we can get them onto the Chromebook? There's lots of different ways. It depends how hard do you want to work, okay? The CSV upload is probably the most straightforward, but it takes the most amount of manual intervention because you actually have to get a download from your student information system or somewhere of all your students, and then you have to upload it manually, and there's a limit Malone, is it 500 still, CSV? I think there's a 500 per upload limit on the CSV. So if you have 10,000 students, you have the joy of uploading 500 at a time. Okay? Probably don't want to do that. But if you have 100 students, CSV upload, simple. Active Directory sync. So if you already have your students in Active Directory and you already have a process for automatically getting student accounts created in Active Directory, there's actually a Google Apps Active Directory sync. It's a little application. It runs on a box. It looks at Active Directory, and it creates student accounts based on their Active Directory accounts, all automatically. Doesn't take too much to set up. There's a pretty decent guide that will walk you through it. All you need to do is get somebody who controls Active Directory to give you access to it, which might be the biggest challenge. There's a couple different solutions for doing a sync from your SIS system. Google Apps School Sync doesn't exactly sync all of your, well, it may sync all of your student accounts, but it's really designed to sync like your grade levels and your groups. So if you have students that are in a class in your SIS, the Google School Sync will actually create that class as a group in Google and put the students in the right class, which then allows you to do some interesting things. Get Clever, it's a third party. They're offering free syncing from your SIS to Google Apps if they have a supported SIS, but if you're on one of the main ones, you are. There's a couple paid options. Hapara is one. Hapara gives you a whole bunch more, which is docs management and some other cool things, but included in that is the ability to sync your SIS student information into Google Apps. And then there's something called URMRA, which is super geeky, but it's basically identity management that does the same thing, but you need like an IT engineer to do it. So, and then there's my favorite option, one at a time, which is if you do CSV upload and then you get those two kids that showed up last week, you're probably doing them one at a time, right? All right, everybody always asks about printing. It's like 2014 and people are still asking about printing. So you can print. It's not that you can't, but my question is why? Why do you want to print? What do you want to print? If you're in an online environment and you're a Google Apps and your kids are collaborating digitally, what are we printing? You know. So if you've had that conversation and there's still a use case for printing, all is not lost. There's Google Cloud Print. Okay. What we've done is we've actually, in our district, we've sent out instructions to every teacher and said, well, we know you all have legacy printers, right? These classic printers, the little printer connected, either USB or network, hopefully, to your Mac or your desktop. Here are instructions on how to enable it for Cloud Print and then add your students to that Cloud Printer. So we've pushed printing out to teachers and said, here you go, here's how you do it. If you need help, let us know. And if you really want to print, this is how you do it. And then what happens is when students go to print, they go to their little Cloud Print and they'll see their classroom printer that's connected on their teacher machine, their teacher's machine, and they can print to that. Couple things, the teacher's machine actually has to be on, right, because it's using that kind of like a little local print server. And kids can print from home, right? They log into Google at home, they're going to see a printer, they can actually hit print, and it will print in your classroom, assuming your teacher laptop is on or desktop is on. So it's not perfect, but you can do it. Okay, to the question of carts. I should have put a progression of the carts that I've been through up here. I've been through a lot of carts. You know, why do we have carts? We have carts for security, we have carts for charging, we have carts for portability, although that's debatable, right? We're actually putting carts out, but we're not going to move them. They're going to stay in the classroom. And why are we doing that? We're doing that primarily because we need a place to charge them now because they're not going home. If we were sending them home with kids, we wouldn't really need carts. We also need a place to store them securely, although I'm pretty sure a crowbar would make short work of any cart I've run into so far. But when I'm looking at a cart, I'm looking at a couple things. And a couple years ago, you know, I think everybody just bought the one cart that everybody was buying. And now there's a lot of options, actually. So I look for warranty. How long is it warrantied? Not only the mechanics, like is the wheel going to fall off 3 years from now and am I going to get a replacement, but also the electronics. Because one of the key benefits of having a cart, especially in an environment where your power may be questionable, If you get a smart charging cart, it will actually cycle through. It won't charge all the devices in the cart. It'll charge, you know, a third or a fourth. And so it's not pulling as much power to do that charge. But there's an electronic chip in there somewhere doing that process. And so the question is, how long is that warrantied for? Because a cart may last 2 cycles of devices, so 3 to 6 years, maybe 6 to 9 years. How long is my electronic timer and charger going to last? So the other thing I look for, which just came up at my new district, is lock type. I had been buying at my previous district carts that had keys, because everybody wanted keys. Now, I'm in a district where everybody wants combo locks. And so you got to weigh the, you know, what are the pros and cons of that? What are you used to in your environment? Not all carts have a key, and not all carts will take a combo lock. So, which I didn't really think about until we had that discussion. So, something that you want to look at. A big one is this flat top. So, the model of cart we were buying previous to this had a big charging thing sticking out of the top. And one of the comments I heard from a teacher is, I can't put anything on that cart. It just sits in my classroom and it's wasted space, right? So now I look for carts that have nothing on top. It's just a flat space. So if teachers want to put their printer or baskets or whatever on top of that cart that's taken up, you know, 3 by 2.5 feet of space in their classroom, they can. We're deploying a lot of these right now. It's Aver's latest tab charge cart, but we have Bretford's and Spectrums and all kinds of ancient computer carts out there. But this one so far has met all of those requirements for me. Well, so hardware warranty is 10 years. This one, the electronics, is 5, hopefully 6, 9, 10 if we can get it. But like I said, within 4 years, all of our students should be taking devices home on a regular basis. And then our charging security needs will pretty much be, you know, at the K1 level. And we won't, hopefully, need to do a cart replacement. Because each cart represents potentially, you know, 5 or 6 devices that you can't buy. So, web filtering. When you go to Chromebooks, you get some interesting possibilities. And I just want to talk about one that we just looked at. It's totally integrated with student Google Apps accounts. So once they log into the Chromebook, they get their web filter policy automatically. And what's cool is it doesn't matter if they're on campus or at home, they just get it. All right, so a lot of us in schools have traditionally tied our web filtering to Active Directory student accounts. And when you go Chromebook, there isn't an AD login anymore. And how do you address that? So looking at different ways to still be able to monitor students is kind of important. So we're using Securely right now, which is working pretty well on our Chromebooks. Okay, I'm going to hit the Today's Meet real quick because I know I got to wrap up. But that's me. And if you want to check out the presentation with all the links, it's right there. And let's see if anybody actually participated online. If a Chromebook is missing, is there a way to at the management level to find it? Not really. You can tell it's online. There's a nice feature in the Chrome Management Console now. You can set a Chromebook. If somebody wipes it, they can only join it back to your domain, so they really can't use it. But unless you're lucky and you drive by Starbucks and see somebody using it with your nice little etched logo on it, yeah, you can't really tell where it is. So. So yeah, as David just pointed out, it does track users, so you can see who's accessing it. So that might give you a clue as well. Any last minute questions? Yeah.
If a student,
question was, if a student takes a Chromebook home, can they log in with their personal Gmail account? You can actually turn that off. You can set your Chromebook to say, only log in with my Google Apps domain accounts, and don't let anybody else do it. So. Not at sub $300 per device. We'll probably offer it as an option. The question was insurance for students, and Chromebooks are really inexpensive, so cost benefit and benefit analysis. Okay, I'm going to wrap up. I'm out of time, but I want to thank you for showing up and learning more about Chromebooks. If you have any questions, just tweet me or contact me and I'll be happy to answer. Thank you.